So basically, Kiko, yeah, the sick, the dying, and the dead is finally released. Like,
Yes.
I think you're starting this one in 2019. And I believe it's kind of put on hold with Dave's illness, cancer, and all that. Then the COVID-19 pandemic in 2020 hit. It was still raging hard in 2021. Then you got the Ellison thing going on and all that. So lots of delayed. Okay, so I won't go into controversy, no, don't worry. So yeah, Oli Oli was a long time in the making. Maybe the most for Megadeth, for a record. So did it feel for you like at some point, like, God, we will never like complete and release this record, you know?
Well, of course, this feeling might have happened at some point, and you know, but also I understand the situations, because we went to 2019, spent a good amount of time, like 2 months and a half around that, in Nashville, creating the songs. And I know that it takes that long. I know the process is like this, because it's not my first album. So I know it is a thing. And then Dave treating the cancer, you know, of course, we have to be by his side and respect, and then it's going to take as long as he needs.
Yeah.
So, I of course, I didn't feel it was natural, it's a natural thing, like just hoping the best for him. Then the COVID-19, you know, the pandemic, also is just like the whole world is suffering. So, I cannot complain that they have, like, you know, that's a minimal thing compared to all the suffering of so many people. So, like, the delay of the album, not possible. I was not possible to go back to Nashville, or Dirk was not possible to go there to finalize the album. You know, it's okay, you know. And then the Ellison thing was an extra, you know, push. And then, of course, so I think I answered your question, right?
Yeah, sure. So it's a very nasty Megadeth record, like definitely one of the fastest, you know, most aggressive to date, you know. There's a good example being like the singles, like Nice Talkers Will Be Back, you know. There's still some more melodic stuff like Mission to Mars and Soldier On, but you know, it's really an aggressive record, really heavy. So were you guys aiming at this kind of dark and heavy thing since the beginning, or was it like also an influence of the bad stuff happening around you, like, you know, Dave's illness, like the COVID, like all that shit?
It's hard to tell, because the album gets its shape during the process, right? And then like songs like Night Stalker, you know, the fast stuff, or We'll Be Back, the two ones, or Celebutant, some songs that I wrote, the main riffs. So that's kind of my perspective of Megadeth, trying to bring also like the early days when I presented those riffs and created those riffs. The same goes for some other songs, like Life in Hell, that Dirk worked with Dave. And then I think Dave also, you know, like, you know, the whole, the cancer, the pandemic, being at home. But I think it's not, all the subjects in a way is not different from other albums. From, so you cannot blame the pandemic. I think it's more like the way we collaborated together, kind of bringing back some aggressive stuff from the past, you know. And then some melodic stuff that, as you said, you know, Killing Time, the song Killing Time, I brought those riffs. And for me, it was like trying to, you know, have a conversation with the 90s Megadeth kind of thing, you know. So, because one thing, well, Dave is Megadeth, right? Because he has been there since the beginning. He knows everything about it. For me, it's more like, okay, I know Megadeth from the outside. So, I see it can be a plus in a way, because I can see Megadeth from a fan's perspective, or from a musician's perspective, or from a, right? So I can bring those ideas with this other perspective. So So I think it works great, because then Dave is the guy, like the gatekeeper. I was like, oh, this is not really Megadeth, you know? So the game is more like for me to present ideas that fits to the Megadeth umbrella, right? It can be like older stuff, more aggressive. It can be 90s, maybe more melodic, yeah. Right? This I'm talking about the music, right? And the lyrics, they wrote them all, right? So it was always an aggressive topics, you know, seeing, or even talking about relationships and things like that, but using that kind of Megadeth vocabulary, right?
Okay. And talking about songwriting and stuff, you have a lot of songwriting credits on this record. I think you're involved in 8 songs, maybe, which is a lot for a Megadeth yeah. record. And definitely more than on Dystopia. And can you tell me how your role evolved and, in the creative process, and how do you usually work with Dave, you know, on ideas?
Yeah, so in the beginning, in the very beginning, even before we got together in Nashville in 2019, I was selecting riffs. I mean, I'm always somehow creating stuff. And then sometimes it's more Megadeth, sometimes it's not very Megadeth. So when I record ideas, can be a simple idea, I try to label them like, oh, that's like MD, that's like mm-hmm. more Megadeth. Like, mm-hmm. so when I met Dave before this going to Nashville, I was like bringing some ideas and recording this with the producer in a way to present the riffs and guitar ideas. So the way Dave works with his ideas, he kind of organized them, you know, label the riffs, the names, it's pretty organized. So then I started working the same way, putting my ideas with the names and the tempos. Gets that's the way they've organized his idea. He has his way, right? So I put my ideas into his way of organization, right? Yeah. With the producer. So I think that's the first step. So I was bringing some ideas that I had, I re-recorded them, and then I was adding more ideas. And so all those guitar riffs from Night Stalkers or We'll Be Back, or Celebutant, and Killing Time, they came from those ideas, you know, from those ideas that I brought before we getting together. And then when we got together, then I would start listening to the ideas and kind of putting them, you know, assembling them, structuring them. They've had, of course, a lot of ideas. So, and then Dirk felt confident to bring his things as well. So it was like, you know, like a good environment, you know. But kind of, we bring our ideas, but we put our ideas in the way Dave likes yeah. to organize them, you know, which is very methodic, you know, which is very good. So it was a good thing, you know, for me also, you know, like the way he does, the way he kind of records. How can I explain that? Because he thinks songs in chunks, in parts. Like, if I'm going to write a song myself, I kind of play a part, then I try to get inspired and go to another one, and then this part inspired me to the third one, and then I try to keep it going in the trying to get the same momentum. Stops, and then I go back and try to play try to get into that vibe again, and then I try to feel the music, feel the song, and try to finish the song, right? Dave doesn't work like this. He's like, he creates a good part, he stops and records that good part. He doesn't keep trying to, oh, what's the next part of this one, and like get inspired and then be jamming forever. He just okay. keep that one, and then he labeled that's like, this is good. I'm not gonna, you know, be trying to create different variations. This is good enough, you know. It's very organized and methodic. So it was even songs like Celebutant, I created a song like this, one part after the other, right? And then I cut it in chunks, you know, so it's easier to understand as well. So also because Dave, sometimes he sings on top, sometimes he's like, oh, let's put a solo on top of this? Or, you know, then you start messing around with those ideas. Can be like this can be an intro, but can be something, a pre-chorus, you know. So then you start labeling the way you feel the parts. It's pretty interesting. It's a bit different than I did in the past.
Yeah, it's really different from being in a band context. It's really different from your solo career as well, I guess. Way different.
As well. Because you have the same kind of person has to listen. The other person has to listen and understand what your idea. So if it's like really well labeled and organized, you can explain better, you know. Yeah.
Okay. And you were mentioning parts and stuff. There's a really strong focus on this record on final part of the songs, I guess, sometimes, which is a formula Megadeth did a lot in the past with like classics such as Anger 18, Holy Wars, Peace Cells. Like on this record, like We'll Be Back and many other stuff, there's strong final part of the song. It's not like you're finishing the song with let's play the chorus or the verse one more time, you know. There's a really strong ending, you know, which is cool. It, to me, makes the thing more like not memorable, I would say. It gives the song some life, like it's more important, you know, than the usual song when you get like a strong ending like that.
Very interesting. So Dave has this because he wrote songs like that in the past, right? So he has this in his way of writing. And then this is something that I like from Megadeth. So the songs evolve. It's not just like, okay, it's a repetition, you know, evolves. So, and then maybe something completely new at the end. That was something that I recognized as a Megadeth style of structure, right? So when I write something or I give an idea or say something, I say like, remember, Megadeth has this unique way of making structures, you know. So I'm there just to remind the guys whatever songs like that, you know.
Okay.
But sometimes the song can be simpler, and then you can do extra stuff like in the end.
Yeah. No, that's cool. You succeeded in doing that on this record, I think. And I think this record is a big statement. For you, you're totally on fire to me on this record, and it's really easy in Megadeth. It's actually the first band in which I was able to distinguish when Dave was doing the leads or when it was Marty or Chris Pollan, you know. So it's really easy to in the, because you got really ripping your head off type of style, you know. And it's always cool to have a guy who play more intricate and melodic stuff, you know, with him completes moment as well. To me, like, it's the best. You're the best fit. I mean, every Megadeth guitar player has been great, indeed. But to me, you're the best fit since Marty Friedman, you know. And and this record, to me, it's really inspired. Your solos really articulate, really tasty, really nice touch, nice vibrato, very melodic, all that. So, you know, so bravo. Really, it's a statement record.
Thank
you. For your lead. Really.
Merci beaucoup.
It feels merci. Like you put some thought into it, just not because it's a given, like you would do great, you know. Just like, even if you go there, like play one or two takes, it'd probably be great, but it seems to be a bit more like that, like more inspired, more tasty, you know, like the average stuff, you know, that you could do.
Thank you.
I mean.
Thank you.
Seems like you put some extra effort into it, to me. Maybe not.
So it depends on the soul. Some songs are more natural, it comes, and then it's like, oh, this is good sometimes. You try some ideas and you're not sure, then you come back, you know. But I was really focused on the songwriting as well. Yeah. But yeah, the solos are fun part, of course. Like, it's like maybe the best moment, you know. The rhythm guitar sucks, you know, to record the rhythm guitars. Because I always like being aware of the tuning and then doubling and then be like trying to be as precise as you can. It's like, and Dave is always like, he has this little tiny little details that it doesn't let it go. It's like, no, Kiko, it has to be it's a bit more muted. This one chord has to be a bit more muted or something like that, you know? So it's like, it's a process, the rhythm guitars, which is, you know, Megadeth is well known for.
Yeah,
so, you know, that's all good. It's just, but the, the solo time, I mean, always like, it's always like this. It's just like more fun to record because it's more, because the riff is basic, is fun when you create the riffs, right? It's fun because you're creating stuff. But then when you have to, you know, put the bricks, you know, like build a house, it's like a lot of work because it has to be perfect. And then and that comes the solo times, you just like relax and try to be creative again. So it's always a great feeling. Sometimes the solos are fast. Just play once, so like a great idea, done. Sometimes you rework the solo to find the right thing, you know.
And there's plenty of those on this record. Like it's like a festival of solos. Really, and there's plenty of solos within each show.
Yeah. Well, yeah, this is like, Megadeth was always a guitar band with a lot of solos. So,
yeah,
you know, that's something that we say in the studio. There was never enough, you know, so it's fine, you know.
And about the touring, I don't remember when was the last time Megadeth did a proper headlining indoor European tour, you know? Because I think you play the festival all the time lately. You did some cool special guest kind of thing and stuff like that. But is there like a headlining indoor European tour in the way, you know, in the works for next year maybe? Or?
I don't know. I think now that the album's out, the, you know, all the cycle restarts, right? Let's say like this. And then, but we do have the festivals, you know, that's like a big thing, you know? So, we did now in, you know, in France, Hellfest. We're coming back to Europe for sure for the summer festival. It's always a great thing. Because the band likes to, you know, it's a cool thing. It's just cool, you know, to do the festivals.
I mean, it's cool to play for a million people at once. But when you're on the fan side, sometimes it's cooler to see sometimes your band, longer set, indoor, you know.
Yes. I do agree with that as well, you know. So starting a new cycle, we're going to Japan as a headliner in February. This is like already announced. Mm-hmm. So they're booking the dates. We just don't say because
it's not right.
If it's not like 100%, it's better not to say anything. So Basically, that situation. But it's starting a new cycle, and of course, we wanna go to different places. So now we're going to Japan. That's booked. That's announced. That's, you know, tickets are, you know, it's all open to buy and all that. So. Yeah, and then some summer, second half of the summer in Europe is going to happen too. That's what we have already announced. It's on the website and all that. But for sure, the idea is to have like the headlining as well.
Okay. And you get obviously like a vast catalog now, Megadeth. So it's hard to put new songs and obscure songs as well in the set list, you know, to sneak in. So you play Soldier On and We'll Be Back so far for the new ones.
Yeah.
And I think you put Sincere, you tried like The Conjuring or Dread and the Fugitive Mind, Angry Again, as far as rarities, I would say.
Yeah.
So so you try to sneak other new songs, you know, like something like Night Stalker, for example, which is crazy. I don't know how he sings and play guitar in the same time with this song because the vocals and the guitar are so much different tempos.
Yeah.
But,
But Dave can, he can do it. You know, We'll Be Back is hard for him to sing. It's hard, like playing and singing, you know. So, we rehearse, we do some sound checks. That's why sometimes take some sound checks, we have a rehearsal room backstage, and then we like always to sound check playing the song. Sometimes you have time during the sound check. Sometimes you have, you know, some technical things that you have to fix. And then the sound check goes. It's not a rehearsal because sound check is to sound check. It's not to rehearse, right? So, but sometimes everything goes smooth in the technical side. Then you have time. Then we're able to sound check the environment that we're going to play, you know, with the videos, because we have the videos, we have the lights, everything has to work. We have the automated patch for the guitars, right? The Neural DSP, the Quad Cortex that I use is all programmed, and Dave is using the Quad Cortex as well. So we have to go through all this. So it's a technical part and the playing part.
Yeah.
Right? And then the singing. So we always do like the technical part first, and then we play with no singing. That Dave doesn't sing. Band, when the band's tight, they start trying out the singing.
To put the, then the we're singing ready. On top, yeah.
Yeah, then you're ready to play live.
And you got any new other new songs ready to go right now?
Well, we wanted, we're discussing about this. You know, I think it would be our Night Stalker, which is a fast one. It's hard.
Yeah.
And then maybe the album title, The Sick, The Dying and the Dead. Yeah.
Okay, okay. And that personally, do you got any, personally, do you got any old one you'd like to dig up in the set at some point? Personally, you. Like,
I was like, because we rehearsed many times, we never played, like the reckoning date.
Oh, yeah,
I like
that
song. You know,
I love Euphanasia. Yeah, it's a great record.
Yeah, exactly.
It's the one I discovered Megadeth with, so I always got a sweet spot for this one.
A Tout Le Monde, yeah.
Addicted to Chaos, all the songs, great.
Exactly, yeah, we have all those great songs, you know. This one is part, I don't know why we don't do it, you know. There's always so many songs, but... It's always also the singing, you know. The thing was that this album, Dave used to sing very high.
Yeah.
You know, after the cancer, you know, aging, and then I think it's just high. The way he used to sing.
Tune lower and lower and lower. away with like the tuning.
But then you cannot go lower than the D standard.
Yeah, yeah.
For Megadeth, doesn't sound Megadeth anymore.
Yeah, it's a standard band in the, I think that Euphanasia originally was in E flat already. I think they were in E flat, standard.
Yeah. So it's already high in E flat. So if you play, you know, if you play D, it's just half step down. So it doesn't help much. It doesn't save, you know.
Maybe you can do it in C sharp.
Maybe. It could be an idea.
Yeah.
No, but we were rehearsing. It was happening. This one, it's possible. I think some other ones are a bit more difficult. You know, Tout Le Monde is possible. We've been doing, you know,
Okay. And so let's talk some gear more specifically while we're at it. So, so do you get any new things with your Ibanez signature guitar? You know, like, is there any new color out or coming out? You know,
we kind of re-released the red one because the red one was a guitar that I was using, was Kiko 100, and then I do right when I joined Megadeth that I used for a while, and then they had the idea of like, I said like it would be good because they discontinued the red one, and I thought, well, we didn't really have that moment with the red one for sale when I was in the Megadeth, you know, because I was using the red one a bit before joining the Megadeth. So they did like last year, like relaunching that color, and then I'm trying discussing with them some other possibilities. Of course, they give me some other. They just gave me a sunburst one, so I can check if I like the color. I can use it's like a is a LA custom shop guitar, but. It's cool, it looks good, so I can decide. But the album I recorded with Kiko 100 is the red one. The green one, the Kiko 200, which
the
is
one
like
I
an
love
RG
is the ball. Charcoal gray type of thing. Like this one, it looks killer.
Yeah. So that's the Kiko 100, the you know the trans black.
Yeah.
So I use this one too. So basically, those three guitars for. Rhythm and solos always this one. I had another RG with the Evertune as well that I used because of the tuning. It's more for rhythms, right? No solos with that because I didn't figure out how to feel natural with the Evertune for the solos. And what else? And that amp, so we basically used the JCM 800 and a Bogner Shiva.
Okay, cool.
And mainly for me, the Bogner Shiva, and then Dave is more like the 800, right? Pedals, few pedals, not, you know, as you can see, there's nothing like
a
lot of crazy
rhythm sound.
Yeah. So it's basically like the Tube Screamer, you know, we tried other pedals there, but it was basically, there was like this the art store, like a boutique.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Boutique at,
yeah.
Booster, yeah.
A booster, and then, you know, the good old TS9. So, yeah, because, okay. You know, Megadeth is like, it's kind of, that's the sound, you know. If you, it's something, when you create a sound, you kind of stay there somehow, you know. If you start trying, I mean, the Wagner is like in the martial direction, you know, so it's a way for me to be different.
Yeah, but you blend those
I play
two.
Differently. Yeah, it blends well, you know, but it's not a Mesa Boogie style.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, Megadeth is not a Mesa Boogie thing. It's not a EVH. My solo album, I did use the Bogners basically, and then some EVH, you know. So, but then it sounds a bit different, you know. It's not, Dave is very like, that's what I use, nothing else, you know, yeah. Not even try, you know.
He uses GVM as well, right? He uses GVM, I think, as well.
Marshalls, yeah. But not all the brands, all the sounds, no.
Okay, we get to wrap these things up in a couple of minutes, apparently. So, real quick, I wanted to ask you, you always play on the HSH configuration, and I want to know if you use it fully with Megadeth, because I think I heard some single coil tones on the last solo of Night Stalker, or maybe just a neck tone, I don't know. I'm not sure.
It's a neck tone, but
it looks single coilish. Yeah. It sounds a single coilish.
Yeah, because I try to put the distortion down, and then just hit harder the string.
Pretty open, pretty quick,
and very open, and the pickups, the demarger pickup, the one that comes with the guitar, has this quality a bit more. It's not so super hot.
Yeah, super hot.
You know, so it kind of, that's my idea for that guitar, my guitar. So I can play metal, but if I still very open to play some fusion to have that kind of tone. That's you know, that you just.
Can you use a single coil sometimes?
Cool. I do use for the cleans, yeah. That's all the time. You know, the fourth position, yes. Second position, sometimes, for the rhythm. Okay. Not with Megadeth.
Okay.
But if I play something else, then I might use the second position. And the fourth position, always live for the cleans in many situations, yeah.
Okay, cool. And the quad cortex, it was a bold movement from you because you were kind of the first guy on the big touring scale to use it,
yeah,
and they were not so much known for hardware. Like Neural DSP was like known for software and plugins, so you had to trust them to do that, I guess. But to bring on the road,
totally. No, but I know the guys pretty well, and then the Quad Cortex is not known for Neural is known for the plugins, not the hardware, but the CEO used to be. I think he sold the company, but the Darkglass.
Yeah, Darkglass, yeah.
Yeah, so he did a lot of hardware. Actually, his expertise would be more hardware than, right?
Yeah.
Not for guitars, but
Vegas,
so he has
Vegas
all
stuff.
This expertise. Yeah, so he has all the expertise for the hardware, all the beautiful boxing, the whole thing. He had this experience already. And then the plugins are already crushing it, you know, great stuff, amazing stuff. So I think it's a great company. I love them, and then it's a great company. And I did take the risk. Yeah, I took three Quad Cortex with me for the tour last year. I would say I was the first one using Quad Cortex live, because
it almost was released during the pandemic. So
yeah, exactly. So I was like, we were one of the first bands, at least like in the size of Megadeth. You know,
yeah.
I'm talking maybe people using in clubs. But in that using also the system, right, that we have the digital performer sending the signal, it's a simple technology, it's MIDI, but we had to try and test, right? So, but it worked perfectly. And then of course we had our old system right there. If things would go wrong, we just switch to the and go back to the old system. Okay. And we do have the rehearsals to test everything. Keaton, my guitar tech, he took the one, we sent him one Quad Cortex. So he was like preparing everything before the rehearsals, bringing everything from the previous equipment, the fractal, and then making everything work. And then it just worked perfectly, nothing. I mean, I just have to adjust a bit, you know, some, like the distortion feels a bit different, live, normal things, you know, the gate reacts a bit different, and then you discover that, but that's like a constant, it's a constant thing. We are like still, every concert, like kind of trying to adjust things and figuring out the best way to use, you know, because we have to use the scenes, you know, the quad cortex has the scenes, the scene mode, right? So we, in the beginning, we're just like to play safe because if we didn't use something new like the scenes, we use the patches, right? Patches, yeah. So every sound has had a different patch. So now the second tour, we're using the scene. So I have one scene that is basically has everything, you know, and then I have maybe I use maybe two or three patches, and then every patch has different scenes, you know. So I have the main scene that has the most of the stuff, the rhythm, the gated rhythm, the cue patch, the so the lead with more delays, you know, the basic stuff, you know, things like that. I don't know if I'm getting too nerdy about this.
No, I mean, but, it's cool. It's cool.
It's a constant work, you know? So now we figure out like, oh, maybe it depends on the song, how we want the patch to be perfect, because it's a machine doing it. It's not me, you know? So sometimes it's better to have a song, a patch dedicated for that song.
Okay, I get it.
So
Do you still use like real cabs live, or is it just now the simulated speaker signal from the quad cortex for the PA?
No, we split. So what we do is like the quad cortex, you have four outs, right? Yeah. And then we send two outs to the monitoring. So it goes to my in-ears.
Yeah.
And it goes PA. Goes to the PA. The other out with no speaker simulator, it goes to the speakers. So okay. I have the Marshall cab, you know.
You
I have
a fourth power amp in between, I guess.
Yes.
Yeah.
We just trying out the Seymour Duncan
power. Yeah, the power stage. Yeah.
Yeah. Just trying.
Right. And so Dave, and you converted Dave as well, you know,
So I did the first tour. Dave doesn't like to change much because things that are if it's working, why change it, right?
Yeah.
So he saw me using during the tour, and then it was so much better. Many things, you know, the how fast it changes, the gate was better, the tone, the delays, the quality. This is all coming from our PA guy, right, Stanley? Yeah. Because in the end, it's like how we feel about the tone, but also how we, you know, how it goes to the public. Yeah. And then Stanley was like, "Oh man, so much better! It's great." And I was like, and Dave saw it. And it's like, man, seriously, like this small little thing here has all this. And then I call the guys from Neuro. So like, well, Dave is, you know, want to try. And then I asked the guy to send one as a present, and then to his tech first, went to his tech. So the tech can familiarize with the whole new system. Right. And then they sent to Dave, and then next tour, all quad cortex. And now Dave is full on, you know, we have the jam room. We used to have like small combos, Marshall combos. We have only quad cortex
on our
practicing room as well, because it's so much easier, you know? And I have one with me to take to the hotel room that I use.
Yeah, and slide.
I use as my sound card.
Yeah.
You know, so I have my computer and a quad cortex. That's it. That's my sound card, even to do all the stuff. You know,
that's cool. And you use like some Marshall simulation on it, or
I'm using the Friedman.
So it's hot-rodded Marshall.
The Marshall sounds great too. You know, it's more like in my case, I found that this one works better for live. Actually, if you have the Neural DSP, you can go to their app and then you can download all the Megadeth is there for free. You know, the ones I use.
Okay. And so I don't know if you realize, that's the last question before I let you, because I think we have a little bit of time left, apparently. Like in 4 years from now, you would be like the longest tenure as lead guitar player in Megadeth. which is crazy, you know. You know,
4 years from now.
Yeah, I guess you would be like 11 years in. I think Marty did 10 years. So, so yeah, if I were you, I would ride these things to the sunset, like till the band is over, you know, and be the last one, you know. I do that. Man, if I were you. I'd be like, like, be the longest guy and be the last one, you know. So, and the mood seems to be really cool between you and James and Dirk. YouTube so videos, cool, yeah, which are great. Like, you're a nice YouTuber, you know. And I mean, it's cool. There's many insight and stuff. And the mood, like, James seems to be always smiling, ready to go. Same with Dirk. And you know, the mood seems to be pretty cool right now, like between you guys.
Yeah, I mean, the relation's great and everything is doing fine, you know. Like, I think, I mean, why not?
Yeah, I mean,
you know, you have like sometimes on the road, it's difficult, you know, it's just difficult in the sense it's like a big brother, you know, you're every day with the same people, you're doing the same things. And then I think the experience of everybody knows that, because we, like 20 years ago, maybe it would be different because little things, you get annoyed by little things. But now, like, we celebrate being possible to play the music that we love. Think about this, you know, it's not a style that, you know, like everybody listen to. I'm playing my guitar solos, you know, I'm playing guitar. That's like amazing crowds and amazing places. You know, there's no, sometimes you get tired. Sometimes you get mad or frustrated or some things, but then you just think, and it's like, man, everything is amazing, you know. So,
yeah, everybody is wiser, older and wiser, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
And the pandemic put perspective on things as well, you know. I mean, things were going great before the pandemic, but I think pandemic helped to put perspectives on things, you know. When you don't have that, you know, you don't play anymore.
Yeah.
Stay at home, which is great to stay at home. I kind of like the pandemic times as well, you know, so well. But so yeah, it's good. I mean, all good, yeah.
Okay,
but
cool.
I don't do the math. I don't count I never thought about this, you know.
But I let you know, in 3 years would be like equal, you know, 10 years, I think, in the band. So.
Okay.
So in 4 years, you're the longest dude as far as lead guitar player goes, you know?
Okay. Yeah, so, I think so the longest is Dave.
yeah, besides Dave, obviously. I mean, I'm talking lead guitar player only, you know, like
I know.
Not bass player or, you know.
Oh, but, the bass player, yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
David Ellefson would be like the longest one, I guess. But
yeah, exactly.
But okay, so thank you for your time, Kiko. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, man.